Oh, man. Alrighty, guys. Well, now that Vias made you guys think for a little while, and now I feel like a sort of washed-up wrestler with that theme music, I appreciate your attention and putting up with the guy in the bear mask on the stage. So I'll try to keep this as somewhat attentive as possible. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the founding story of BearChain, how we actually ended up here, and in a perfect world, what our end game looks like, and what a perfect world for BearChain turns into. So, you know, no one really knows what BearChain means, but we know that it's provocative, and it really gets the people going, and that's kind of what I'm here for. So we'll first start with the basics. What is BearChain? As Raj was kind enough to say, BearChain is an EVM equivalent layer one blockchain. It is built on top of the Cosmos SDK from a validator logic point of view, and is powered by something called proof of liquidity. But before I dive into proof of liquidity and the fun technicals and all the things that we have to think about, I'm going to tell you guys a story about bears and blockchains. So BearChain, as Raj noted, started with 100 JPEGs of bears smoking weed. I'd love to say there was a grand vision, an end game, a goal of building a massive blockchain ecosystem. There was nothing of the sort. There was myself and my co-founder, Papa, who can be found somewhere in the background, with a number of odd days in DeFi Summer 2.0, spending our time in NFT communities like Parallel and starting to see the rise of this new NFT meta that wasn't just 10K profile pictures, that wasn't just, you know, scams, but was actually something a little bit more interesting in this idea of utility-driven NFTs. And we thought to ourselves, maybe we could do something with this. So we took 100 pictures of bears, we raffled them off in a number of different DeFi communities, and almost 3 years later, we found ourselves with the most active testnet in crypto history with, you know, 9 million plus users, over 100 million transactions, and recently just closed our Series B funding round of $100 million, co-led by Brevin Howard Digital and Framework Ventures. So we're excited to be here. We're not exactly sure how it happened, and that's what we're going to try to figure out along the way here. So, you know, the origins of BearChain, we had these NFT projects, and then we made these NFTs rebase over time. So rebasing, if you're familiar with this concept, effectively means multiplying, right? So you had one set of NFTs that evolved into another set of NFTs that evolved into another set of NFTs. What this meant was that we actually ended up bringing a community of thousands of holders of these you know, bear JPEGs together over time without intentionally doing so. And having seeded them from these DeFi communities, we found a number of interesting things happening. So, you know, just to go over the economies of scale, if you will, you start with one, and if you had one, you get two, you get four, eight, 16, you understand the math. What becomes very interesting here is that it actually became a simple mechanism for incentivizing the earliest members and the most devoted people within that ecosystem or that community, if you will, while actually serving as a distribution mechanism as well. As the scarcity decreased, as the number of these NFTs increased, we found more and more community members able to enter the ecosystem at a more affordable price. So what actually happened here next was really interesting in that, you know, when we look at the way the most L1s to date have come to market, they've been the product of a major technical evolution or, you know, an advancement spun out of a research facility like Cornell or Yale or whatever it might be. And then, you know, you take this tech and you try to build a community, you try to build a narrative around this new consensus mechanism, this paralyzed EVM, whatever it might be. What we actually did was kind of the opposite. As mentioned, right, the BearChain community came together from all these DeFi communities bound together by a love of stupid JPEGs of bears smoking weed. And what we actually ended up doing was something that I also think sometimes goes less commonly done in the space, which is we talk to the users. We spend time in Discord with them. We spend time understanding their problems. We spend time trying to figure out the applications that they used, what worked, what didn't, and what they wanted to see change. And what we actually ended up having more than anything else was a community that was very emblematic of what you call like either barbell or a horseshoe type distribution, in which the far left and the people who thought, funny JPEG of a bear, I'm gonna buy this, and the far right who thought, okay, these guys might be onto something interesting, ended up converging on their opinions. So what we actually found was a kind of interesting logical fallacy in proof of stake chains, which is that when you think about a proof of stake network, you actually have a massive amount of capital in a lot of these alt L1s especially that is sitting in a validator set, you know, keeping the network incredibly secure, well validated, et cetera, but taking away from the actual liquidity that's available on the network, which seems like an inherently problematic trade in that if you want to have a blockchain that actually gets use and has applications, has users, has transactions, is driving real value, you don't want that blockchain to have all its capital locked in a validator set rendered relatively unusable. You'd see these chains with hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars securing the network, but with $5 to $10 million actually active on the chain. And it begs the question of why is there this set of traverse incentives between liquidity and security at the network scale? And this was really what inspired the idea of proof of liquidity. proof of liquidity and, you know, by virtue of that, Bearchain was meant more than anything else to make liquidity flexible, to allow users to turn their liquidity into a safe, secure form of security without sacrificing any of their potential, without introducing leverage risk or anything of the sort. So I'll tell you how that actually works. The way that works on Bearchain is that security and or the staking token of the network can only be earned by providing liquidity to the network itself. The way this works is that as the chain goes live, there are a set of very basic DeFi primitives that are built into the chain. There's a decentralized exchange, there's a perpetual futures vault, there's a stablecoin lending platform that users can LP into and earn block rewards in the form of this staking token in the network. And contrary to most proof-of-stake chains, as opposed to the validators reaping the majority of the block rewards on Bearchain, these actually go towards the applications. And beyond the applications, they go to the users who are providing liquidity to the network itself. So what that means is that as we talk to all these different builders, we realize that one of the biggest problems they faced was that when selecting a chain, they actually had no reason to choose chain A versus chain B from a mechanistic perspective. It was a game of momentum, it was a game of hype, but there was never a place where they actually had an entrenched economic advantage by building on a given network. And Bearchain, and by virtue of that, proof of liquidity, set out to fix this by allowing Bearchain to actually power its applications from the validator set directly. So when you think about this, the way that it works, users work with validators, they stake with those validators. Those validators, in turn, direct liquidity towards different applications, and users work with those applications to make the cycle go whole. That's sort of the idea of the proof of liquidity flywheel, if you will. So we'll go through the tokenomics and the structure really quickly. The funky thing about Bearchain is that, we figured that one token hasn't always worked in the past. So we thought that two tokens must be better than one, hence the idea of BGT and Bera. BGT is the Bera governance token. The name is a little bit on the nose, so it actually serves two purposes. One is governance, and two, staking. BGT is what validators stake to secure the network. And the funky thing about BGT is that as much as we love Raj, you can't go and market buy it on Binance. You actually have to do the work of providing liquidity to the network in order to earn BGT. So it is entirely illiquid. It is entirely not purchasable. And BGT is what is used to control emissions across the chain. So each validator, depending on the amount of BGT that they hold, is able to direct its emissions and its block rewards towards different applications across the network. BGT holders earn fees from the applications that are receiving these BGT emissions on the network, such that they actually have a reason to hold the token and to benefit from the volume and the activity on the network. Then we have Bera, gas token to the network. Pretty simple. You use it to pay transaction fees. You use it to have a liquid token, and at any point in time, one BGT or one Bera governance token can be burned into one Bera. So the way that we actually think about this more than anything else is that what Bearchain fundamentally does is realigns value. In a traditional proof-of-stake chain, you have value that's effectively flowing from the users to the dApps to the validators. In this case, the validators are actually driving value to the applications and then the users themselves of those applications. So we'll go through the stakeholder analysis really quickly. Validators effectively control the flow of block rewards and therefore where liquidity wants to go across the network. And it uses it basically works with protocols to incentivize different pools, such that for the first time, a protocol building on the network can actually choose to work with a validator to directly bootstrap its own liquidity or the usage of its own smart contracts. These validators also can earn commissions on transaction fees as they would on any other network, while being able to actually have that added upside of working with protocols to earn a portion of their token supply, their rewards, so on and so forth. Protocols themselves are actually able to work with validators and use the governance system to make their own smart contracts eligible for BGT emissions, such that in the same way as the native DEX or lending market could earn BGT emissions, this could be applicable to any protocol on the chain, such that anyone building on Bearchain can actually benefit from its infrastructure. So those protocols tend to work with validators to incentivize them to direct more emissions towards them and try to, of course, compete as much as possible to get as many users, fees, application bonuses, if you will. And finally, look at the users. Our goal was to make this whole experience as native, seamless, and thoughtless as possible for users. They contribute liquidity to applications as the same way as they would in any other environment to earn BGT. They then are actually able to vote with that BGT with validators to choose where emissions and liquidity goes across the network. And the users truly do win here in that they earn trading fees, they earn block rewards in BGT, and they earn incentives based on the validators that they work with. So what this really sums up to at the end of the day is that Barrachain's direction and Barrachain's evolution as an ecosystem is very much determined not just by those who buy the most tokens, but by those who've contributed the most tangible value to the ecosystem in the form of liquidity that everyone can interact with. So I think the question this begs more than anything else is, like, why does any of this matter, right? Why is on-chain liquidity cool? Why do applications need to be powered by chains, so on and so forth? And I think this sort of dials back to, I think this kind of dials back to something that is partially a meme, but partially a reality in crypto, which is that we've always talked about this next million or next billion users thesis. And our strong belief is that in order to actually reach real adoption and to bring the next million or next billion users on chain, we actually need to have applications which exist that are only uniquely available in an on-chain environment and that could only live on-chain in a verifiable, trustless, permissionless environment. Otherwise, why wouldn't you just use a Web2 alternative? And as we see ourselves as Barrachain, as a sum of all the applications that are built on top of us, this means that our job is to help as many builders as possible really reach escape velocity and find their way to actually break out of just the crypto circles. So more than anything else, we see Barrachain as a force multiplier and something that allows an application to, you know, grow wings. Now, we're in the earliest stages of this all happening, but when we think about where this is right now, we've seen great signs of initial success. There are 200 plus projects building in the Barrachain ecosystem. There are over 10 novel DeFi primitives. There are 5 plus projects with over a million users apiece that are building on the network right now. We've got 50 plus different projects planning to launch their tokens on Barrachain. And while fundraising is by no means a mark of success, it's definitely a mark of interest. And we found that even prior to launch, there are 10 different ecosystem projects that have collectively raised well north of $25 million already. So the way that we really see this is that in a perfect world, Barrachain is the best place to take your application from 0 to 1. And our goal, our dream, is that if this all works out properly, then Barrachain ends up being the place that allows you to build that next category-defining DeFi application or consumer or social application. We want the next Uniswap moment for crypto to exist on Barrachain, and we hope that with proof of liquidity, we can make that a reality. Thanks so much, guys.